أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد والثناء لله رب العالمين ثم الصلاة والسلام على خاتم الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا ونبينا محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد
ولعنة الله على أعدائهم ومنكر فضائلهم من الآن إلى قيام يوم الدين رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي ثم أما بعد فقد قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه الكريم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وجعلوا لله شركاء الجن وخلقهم وخرقوا له بنين وبنات بغير علم سبحانه وتعالى عما يصفون صدق الله العلي العظيم صلوا على محمد وآل محمد
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد
الحمد لله we've reached ayah number 100 the surah has 165 verses so inshallah in every session I'll try to do roughly about 10 verses so we can start to move through the surah, and we can move on to other chapters of the Quran. In this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala essentially is addressing the Meccans, because as you know, this is a late Meccan surah, so the primary addressees, the primary audience of the surah are the Meccans. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here, and in the next couple of verses, he's directing a criticism, of the misguided attributions that people have made to God in Arabia and by extension throughout human history. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, but they have attributed to God partners, the jinn, while he has created them and they have fabricated for him sons and daughters. Exalted is he and above what they describe. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here tells us that people in general, they have a tendency when they see anything, any being that is supernatural, that possesses supernatural abilities, they automatically ascribe and associate that supernatural being with God. Now, as you know, jinn are supernatural creatures. They possess abilities that are beyond the power of human beings. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that there are some people who have claimed that the jinn are partners of God. Now in Arabia, there was a tribe by the name of Banu Malih, which was known for associating the jinn as partners with God. So as I said, because they possessed, you know, these extraordinary powers, there were some people that automatically assumed that because they possess these abilities, they must be divine. So this tendency to attribute divinity to creatures or to beings that possess supernatural abilities is a pretty common theme in human history. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that there are also those who have fabricated and ascribed sons and daughters to me. Now, with respect to sons, the most obvious example of this is, you know, what has been done in the religion of Christianity, where Jesus is recognized as the Son of God. In the Jewish tradition, we find that there are certain sects that have claimed that Uzair, who is the prophet of God, Uzair was the son of Allah. And this is referenced in Surah Al-Baqarah. وَخَرَقُوا لَهُ بَنِينَ وَبَنَاتِ بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ Whether it's jinn, whether it's sons, even daughters. You know, interestingly, the Quran tells us that the ancient Arabs believed in angels, but they believed that these angels were the daughters of God. So you have certain tribes in Arabia that believe that the jinn were God's partners. There are religious traditions that ascribe sons to God, like in Christianity and certain sects in Judaism. And Even daughters have been ascribed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if you look at Surah Zukhruf, ayah number 19, Allah very clearly tells us, وَجَعَلُوا الْمَلَائِكَةَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ عِبَادُ الرَّحْمَانِ إِنَاثًا, that the Arabs had this belief that the angels were female. And in other verses, Allah tells us that they ascribed them to me as my daughters. So a jinn have been ascribed to Allah as partners. People have made the claims that God has sons, God has daughters. But again, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refutes this by reminding us that I created them. Whether it's jinn, whether it's those who you claim to be my sons, Jesus Christ, Uzair, others, the angels that you claim are my daughters, the Quran repeatedly reminds us that the only relationship Allah has to everything is the relationship of the creator and the created. You're either, there's only two categories. You're either al-Khaliq, which is only Allah, or you're the makhluq. So everything other than Allah is makhluq. And therefore the only relationship to Him is the relationship of a creator to a created being. And the ayah ends by saying, they make these attributions, they assign partners to me, sons to me, daughters to me, بغير علم. If you sit with anyone who believes that the jinn are partners of God, Allah tells us that this is not based on knowledge, this is not based on rational arguments. If you sit with those who claim that God has sons or daughters, again, this is all based on wahm, this is based on whim. It's not based on ilm. It's not based on rational argumentation. It's not based on logic. And this also is an implicit reminder that we have to base all of our aqa'id on ilm. You as a Muslim should not believe in anything unless there is evidence for it, unless it's based on a confirmed, an authentic tradition from a prophet, or it's based on revelation, or it's based on intellectual arguments, rational thought. You should not adopt any belief that is not rooted in knowledge and rational thought. Verse 101. I'm going to skip over. I don't want to go into too much detail, because believe me, if you let me talk freely, we'll spend a half an hour on this verse. So moving on to the next verse. Ayah number 101. بَدِيعُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ أَنَّا يَكُونُ لَهُ وَلَدٌ وَلَمْ تَكُنْ لَهُ صَاحِبًا وَخَلَقَ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ وَهُوَ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عَلِيمٌ. He is the originator of the heavens and the earth. بَدِيع means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought everything into existence for the first time without an example set for him. You know, brothers and sisters, when you and I want to create something, usually we have some sort of template to refer to. If you want to design a home, if you want to build a car, you have examples of homes, of cars that were built by others to go off of. So it's easy for you and I to create these things because we have templates, we have pre-existing examples. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-badi'. When Allah created the universe, it's not that He had a template. That you see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He brings things into being, He brings them into existence for the first time without any examples, without any references. He's al-Badir. He possesses an unlimited creative power. So He originated the heavens and the earth. أَنَّا يَكُونُ لَهُ وَلَدٌ. So here, so in verse 100, Allah mentions examples of entities that were given divinity, that were ascribed as partners. He mentions jinn, sons, and daughters. In verse 101, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala specifically speaks about sons. Because if you look at the major world religions today, the most common attribution, the most common entity that is ascribed to Allah is that He has a son, right? You have almost 2 billion people around the world who believe that God has a son. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala specifically addresses this idea that He has a son. And He refutes it using one argument. One possible way of refuting this is that Allah says, how can I have a son when I don't have a spouse, a partner? Because in this earthly realm, we have offspring. Again, this is the typical way that offspring come into being. You have offspring because of a sexual union between a male and a female, between a male and a female partner. Allah says, I don't have a female partner. As was mentioned in the previous verse, I created everything. I cannot have a partner because there is nothing but me. Everything that exists, again, the relationship it has to me is the relationship of a khaliq and a makhluq. There's no sahiba, there's no partner, because I created everything. وَخَلَقَ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ وَهُوَ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عَلِيمٍ. Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, not only did I create everything, but I am aware of everything. You know, it's one thing to bring something into being. You know, you can, for example, create a car, right? You can design a car, but it doesn't necessarily mean that you know every single thing about it, right? There might be some things that you're not aware of. Allah creates and He has full awareness of His creation at all times. So you might design a certain thing, a computer, you might build a house, and you might know about it for a certain period of time. But then you might go away and you might lose contact with that thing. But here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I create and I am al-alim. I always know about my creation. So I create them and I have full awareness of their realities. Verse 102. ذَلِكُمُ اللَّهُ رَبُّكُمْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُوَ خَالِقُ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ فَعْبُدُوهُ وَهُوَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ وَكِيلٌ. That is God, your Lord. There is no God but Him, the creator of all things. So worship Him, and He is the guardian of all things. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, this is the proper understanding of God. If you want to know who is God, what is the nature of God, He is the creator of all things. He doesn't have partners. He doesn't have sons. He doesn't have daughters. He's omnipotent. He's omnipresent. He's all-knowing. ذَلِكُمُ اللَّهُ. This is God. This is the Lord who is worthy of worship. Not a Lord who has a partner. Not a Lord who has a son. Why would He need a son? You and I, we have children because we're worried that if we're in our 70s, we need someone to take care of us. He is al-hayy al-qayyum. Allah never perishes. He never dies. He has no need for a son. You and I, we have children because we want to fill a void, right? We don't want to live in an empty house, right? We want to have children. We want to fill this emotional void. We want to pass on our knowledge to our children so we can live through them. We can live vicariously through them. Allah has no need to have partners because He's all powerful. He has no need to have children because He's always going to be there. There's no emotional void for Him to fill because He's needless. Dhalikumullah. This is God. La ilaha illahu. There is nothing that's worthy of worship other than Him. There is nothing that deserves to be the object of your unconditional love except Him. Because everything else is limited. Everything else is finite. Everything else is perfect. The only thing that is worthy of your attention, that is worthy of your love, is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is worthy of making Him the direction of your life, that you orient yourself towards Him. La ilaha illahu. There's no other Lord but Him. There is no other deity but Him. Khaliqu kulli shay. Again, reaffirming this idea that he is the creator of all things. There is not a single thing that you can point to in this universe that you can say that this is man-made. Even what you think is man-made was designed and manufactured by people who use raw materials created by Allah, who use the minds that Allah gave them to create this laptop that I'm using. In fact, Allah created the human beings themselves. So Allah is the creator of all things. It's amazing that there's not a single atom in this universe that you can point to and say, okay, God didn't create this, but he created everything else. Khaliqu kulli shay is the creator of all things. Fa'budu, so worship him. And ibadah doesn't only mean that you stand for prayer. Ubudiyah encompasses not only your salah, make him the object of your worship and everything. Have the mindset of Ibrahim alayhi salam, inna salati wa nusuki wa mahyaya wa mamati lillahi rabbil alameen, that my prayers, my rituals, my life, my death are for him. This is ibadah, to do things for his pleasure. وَهُوَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ وَكِيلٍ, and he's the guardian of all things. He's in charge of all things. This is tawheed. Tawheed is not to only believe that Allah is the creator of all things, but it's to really have firm conviction that Allah is the one who's in charge. I don't care who's the president. I don't care who's the king or the emperor. Allah is the one who's in charge, irrespective of what people may think. Forget about who's sitting on the kursi. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who is in charge. Verse 103. لا تدركه الأبصار وهو يدرك الأبصار وهو اللطيف الخبير. Vision perceives him not, but he perceives all vision. And he is above all comprehension, yet is acquainted with all things. This is one of my favorite verses in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cannot be seen with the physical eye. You know, there were many individuals who came to the Prophet, other Imams of Ahlul Bayt, and they would ask the Imams, they would ask the Prophets, show us God. In fact, even in the Quran, we know that Bani Israel, they said to Musa, again, they were spiritually immature people, they say, Ya Musa, لن نؤمن لك حتى نرى الله جهرة. Oh Musa, we will never believe in you until we see God directly with our eyes. There were people who came to Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam. I'll just share with you this short story where someone comes to Imam al-Sadiq and he says to him, Ya Ibn Rasulullah, show me God. I want to see him with my eyes. It was a sunny day. The sun was in the sky. The Imam alayhi salam, he says, look at the sun. The man looked up and immediately he averted his gaze. The Imam said, why did you turn away? He said, oh Imam, the rays of the sun are damaging my eyes. Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam, he says, if you cannot see the created, you want to see the creator? The sun is makhluq and you cannot handle your vision. Cannot handle the rays of the sun. You want to see the creator? He's beyond vision. To be able to see something, it has to have a shape. It has to be made up of parts. Because your eye can only capture that which is limited. It has to be confined by space and time. And Allah is the creator of space and time. So vision perceives him not, but he perceives all vision. Meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you cannot see him, but there is nothing that Allah cannot see. There are many things that you cannot see. Now you can see me, but can you see protons and neutrons with your naked eye? You can't. Can you see electrical currents? You can't see it. But there is nothing that is invisible to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is invisible to us. The eye cannot comprehend him, cannot grasp him, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he grasps all things. وَهُوَ اللَّطِيفُ الْخَبِيرُ. Now the word Latif, again, Latif is one of the names of Allah. It can have different meanings depending on the context. One of the meanings of Al-Latif is the one who is kind. But in this context, we're speaking about the incomprehensibility of God. So in this context, Latif means, because angels, for example, are referred to by philosophers as ajsam latifa. They have subtle bodies, meaning that you cannot detect them because they have subtle bodies. Jinn are also known to have ajsam latifa. When we're in alam al-barzakh, our bodies in barzakh are ajsam latifa, light bodies, because they're not we cannot perceive them. Here Allah is al-latif, because He's incomprehensible. You cannot perceive Him. And after Allah mentions His attribute of being Al-Latif, He mentions Al-Khabir. وَهُوَ اللَّطِيفُ الْخَبِيرُ. It's a beautiful contrast. In one sense, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is inaccessible. You cannot perceive Him. He's distant. His essence is far away. It's distant. It's elusive. But just because Allah is almost as though Allah is saying, just because your mind cannot reach me, it doesn't mean that I'm far away from you. I am khabir. I'm very acquainted with all things. So on the one hand, you cannot perceive me. I'm beyond the reach of your intellect. But on the other hand, I'm so close to you. I am al-latiful khabir. Verse 104. قَدْ جَاءَكُمْ بَصَائِرٌ مِّنْ رَبِّكُمْ فَمَنْ أَبْصَرَ فَلِنَفْسِهِ وَمَنْ عَمِيَ فَعَلَيْهَا وَمَا أَنَا عَلَيْكُمْ بِحَفِيظٍ. There has come to you enlightenment from your Lord. This is a beautiful way to speak of revelation. You know, most people think of religion as a set of do's and don'ts. Something boring, something that's going to restrict my life. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that my wahi, this Quran, my religion that I have conveyed to my prophet, it's enlightenment. Is there any human being that says, you know, I'm not interested in being an enlightened person? Allah says, you want enlightenment? Enlightenment is in the Quran. Enlightenment is following the instructions of the prophets, adhering to the guidance of the most enlightened people, which are the prophets. Is there anyone who's more enlightened than Ibrahim? Is there anyone who's more enlightened than Musa? Is there anyone more enlightened than Rasulullah, Amir al-Mu'mineen, Imam al-Hussein? These are enlightened people. They're enlightened because they're obedient to Allah. The word basair is the plural of basira. Basira means insight. Islam, adherence to the Book of Allah, makes you an insightful person. Everyone has eyesight, right? Most people, they can see with their physical eyes. They have basar. But very few people have basira. Basira, basar is eyesight. Basira is insight. So Allah says, there has come to you enlightenment from your Lord. This is not enlightenment from Socrates, right? There are many people, the moment they hear the name Aristotle, they jump. They have to listen because they want enlightenment. Allah says, this is enlightenment from your Creator. You line up to listen to words from my creation, right? You want inspiration from them? Allah says, this is enlightenment from me, from the Creator of the heavens and the earth. قَدْ جَاءَكُمْ بَصَائِرٌ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ فَمَنْ أَبْصَرَ فَلِنَفْسِهِ. So whoever will see does so for the benefit of his soul. Always keep in mind, my respected brothers and sisters, that when you connect to the Quran, when you follow the guidance of the Quran, Allah is not the beneficiary. Allah does not benefit from your obedience, nor is He harmed by your disobedience. Allah says, if you obey, if you make this book the source of your enlightenment, you are the beneficiary. You're doing it for your own soul, Your soul craves nur. It craves enlightenment. And you will find it here. وَمَنْ عَمِيَ فَعَلَيْهَا. Whoever chooses to be blind, chooses to turn away, Allah is not going to interfere with your free will. If you want to be illuminated, you do it for your own sake. You do it for your own soul. If you choose to turn away and be blind, Allah says you have to deal with the consequences. وَمَنْ عَمِيَ فَعَلَيْهَا وَمَا أَنَا عَلَيْكُمْ بِحَفِيظٍ. Here the Prophet is saying that I'm here to deliver the message. I'm here to educate, to inspire, to enlighten those who are interested. I'm not, my job is not to be hafiz, to be a guardian and to coerce you into submitting. Because you will only taste the sweetness of faith if you do it voluntarily, if you choose to follow the guidance. So the Prophet says, I'm not in charge of the results. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commissioned me with the deliverance of the message. I'm not going to breathe over your neck and, you know, force you and compel you to follow. That's not my job. Verse 105. وَكَذَلِكَ نُصَرِّفُ الْآيَاتِ وَلِيَقُولُوا دَرَسْتْ وَلِنُبَيِّنَهُ لِقَوْمٍ يَعْلَمُونَ. And thus we diversify the verses or the signs. So the disbelievers will say, you have studied. And so we make the Quran clear for people who know. Now, what does it mean when Allah says we diversify the signs? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala understands, of course, He's our creator. In the same way that people are diverse, Allah's messages, His signs necessarily have to be diverse. There are some people, for example, when they read the Quran, the story of Nabi Yusuf really resounds with them, right? Because they had life experiences that, you know, relate to the struggles and the challenges of Yusuf. There are others that find inspiration in the story of Ibrahim, in the story of Maryam in the Quran. There are some people who respond better to verses that promise reward. Others, you know, are incentivized by fear of punishment. So because people are different, you find that the Quran employs a diverse range of ways to draw people to the truth. So because people are diverse, people are different. You know, I know there are some people that they need to read about Jahannam, right, to wake up. And there are some people that, listen, the promise of reward is enough. They can read Surah Ar-Rahman, read the bounties that Allah has prepared, and that's enough to motivate them. And there are others who are so spiritually elevated that it's not about Jannah or not. It's about being close to Him. Divine proximity is enough. So because people are different, we go through different things in life. Humanity is very diverse. The verses of the Quran are diverse. There are certain surahs that are going to impact you more than others, especially at a certain period of time in your life. Maybe when you get older, the verses of the Quran that didn't really do anything for you when you're younger, they start to have a profound impact on you. وَكَذَلِكَ نُصَرِّفُ الْآيَاتِ وَلِيَقُولُوا دَرَسْتِ. One of the things that the Meccans used to accuse the Prophet of is that they used to say that, oh Muhammad, you weren't known for reading or writing. So the Quran must be the product of you studying with Jewish scholars or Christian scholars. That you must have borrowed this from previous scriptures. Basically, the accusation here is that you plagiarized, right? They're accusing the Prophet of plagiarizing. Yeah, you studied with, you know, religious scholars. If you look at the biography of the Prophet, this is impossible. Number one, Rasulullah grew up in Arabia. In Arabia, Arabia was not known to be a center of learning. Yes, there were no, you know, schools in Arabia. It wasn't like, you know, Plato's academy in Athens. Arabia had no schools. There were no educational institutions. It wasn't a civilization that produced philosophers. If you say, oh, how about his trips to Yemen and Syria, where he met with you know, some Christian monks? Yeah, Rasulullah met with him for a few minutes. He didn't spend years studying with a Christian monk. So these are all unfounded claims that the Prophet studied and he borrowed from the Torah and the Injil and he just did some copy-paste exercise. There's no evidence for that. There's absolutely no indication that the Prophet did anything like that. In fact, there are many things in the Quran that call into question many passages in the Bible and the Torah. So if he was just copying and pasting, the Quran would be a mirror of the Torah and the Injil. But there are many fundamental things that the Quran criticizes about Christian theology and even Jewish theology. Ayah 106, اتَّبِعْ مَا أُوحِيَ إِلَيْكَ مِنْ رَبِّكَ لَا إِلَهِ إِلَّا هُوَ وَأَعْرِضْ عَنِ الْمُشْرِكِينَ. O Muhammad, Allah is speaking to the Prophet, follow what is being revealed to you. You know, when you're a leader, especially when you're the leader of a new religious movement, you're going to be attacked. You're going to be slandered. You're going to be insulted. You're going to be abused. You're going to be vilified. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells the Prophet, don't let that demoralize you. Don't let that break your resolve. Follow what is being revealed. There is no God but me. You need to worry about me. Because when you die, you return to me. When you die on the day of judgment, you stand before me. You're not going to stand before Abu Jahl. You're not going to stand in front of Abu Sufyan. You're not going to stand in front of the aristocrats of Mecca. There is no God but me. وَأَعْرَضْ عَنِ الْمُشْرِكِينَ. Turn away from the polytheists. Now, what does it mean when Allah says turn away from them? You know, the Prophet, his duty is to guide all people, right? He's the mercy to the worlds. Turn away from them doesn't mean give up on them, throw in the towel and let them go to hell. What it means is, Ya Rasulullah, turn away, meaning do not let their abusive language demoralize you. Don't let that affect you. And that's easier said than done, brothers and sisters. You know, you and I, we get upset if someone gives us a dirty look, yeah? Imagine, you know, day in and day out, verbal abuse, every single day, campaigns to slander you, character assassination, you know, literal assassination attempts. Allah tells the Prophet, you know, just ignore them, ignore them, ignore them, ignore them. Because your job is to do what, Ya Rasulullah? As Allah says in Surah Yasin, what's the slogan of all prophets? وَمَا عَلَيْنَا إِلَّا الْبَلَاغُ الْمُبِينَ. Our job is to convey the message. Some people are going to embrace us, others are going to launch attacks. But Allah always reminds them. Because even prophets, you know, prophets are human beings. No human being likes to be attacked. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala consoles them. Turn away from them. Don't take the bait, right? Turn away from their slandering and their abuse. Don't let it demoralize you. Verse 107, وَلَوْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ مَا أَشْرَكُوا. This is important, brothers and sisters. If Allah had willed, none of them would associate partners with me. They would all be believers. So Ya Rasulullah, don't think for a moment that because you're going through difficult times, that in some way they are overpowering you. As long as you have Allah on your side, it doesn't matter who's on the other side. As long as Allah is on your side, it doesn't matter who's on the other side. Allah says, if I wish, I can make them all believers. The only reason why they are rejecting is because I gave them the privilege of free will. I created a system where you can voluntarily come to me. But I could have made them like the sun and the moon. You rise and set and you have no choice. وَلَوْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ مَا أَشْرَكُوا وَمَا جَعَلْنَاكَ عَلَيْهِمْ حَفِيظًا وَمَا أَنْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ بِوَكِيلٍ. Ya Rasulullah, you're not a hafiz and you're not a wakil. Two words are used. Hafiz, according to some commentators of the Quran, means the one who protects you from harm is your hafiz, your guardian. And your wakil is the one who secures benefit for you. You know, I appoint someone as my wakil to sell my house. A wakil, the primary function of a wakil is to secure benefit for you. The primary function of a hafiz is to protect you from harm. Allah says, Ya Rasulullah, you're neither of them for these people. Your job is not to secure their benefit or to protect them from harm. They have to believe in you. You don't have control over their hearts. They have to make the initiative. They have to make that first step. They have to be proactive. They have to take their spirituality. They have to take their spirituality seriously. They have to take control of their own destiny. Verse 108. وَلَا تَسُبُّ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ فَيَسُبُّ اللَّهَ عَدْوًا بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ كَذَلِكَ زَيَّنَّا لِكُلِّ أُمَّةٍ عَمَلَهُمْ ثُمَّ إِلَىٰ رَبِّهِمْ مَرْجِعُهُمْ فَيُنَبِّئُهُمْ بِمَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is, wallah, brothers and sisters, this is a verse that I think we as an ummah really need today. Now, the context of this verse is the following. So again, we're talking about a Meccan surah. In Mecca, you have a society where the minority are Muslims. The majority, the powerful majority, are mushrikeen, idol worshippers. So you can imagine that the believers, day in and day out, they're seeing people worshiping idols, ascribing partners to Allah. Some of the believers became so agitated, so bothered when they would see the mushrikeen worshiping idols, associating partners with God, that some of the Muslims would actually insult the idols that were being worshipped, or they would insult the disbelievers. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives an important command. وَلَا تَسُبُّ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ. Do not insult those who they invoke other than Allah. Why? فَيَسُبُّ اللَّهَ عَدْوًا بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ. If you insult the religious figures of a certain group, or you insult the gods of a certain group of people, what's going to happen? When you provoke people, when you attack people's religious beliefs, right? I'm not talking about academic discussions or healthy dialogue. I'm talking about insult, seb. Allah says if you insult their idols, they're going to retaliate by insulting God and slandering God. And guess who's going to be responsible? You become the cause of blasphemy. You become the reason why this person committed another sin. As a believer, do you want to be responsible for being the reason why people curse God? Why people slander and insult God? Allah says, don't do that. There's a wiser way of attracting people to faith. You don't need to use inflammatory language. You don't need to denigrate people. وَلَا تَسُبُّ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ فَيَسُبُّ اللَّهَ عَدْوًا. They do it out of animosity, بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ, without knowledge. They're doing it because you provoke them. The last thing that you ever want to do with people who are ignorant or people who are misguided is provoke them. Rasulullah was not a provoker. Now, it's interesting that Fakhr al-Razi, he's a prominent Sunni mufassir of the Quran, he has an interesting observation, and I think it's definitely worth mentioning here. He says that it's highly unlikely that the mushrikeen of Mecca would respond to an insult against their idols by insulting Allah. Why? Because they believed in Allah. Brothers and sisters, the mushrikeen of Mecca, yes, they worshipped idols, but they were worshipping their idols to gain nearness to Allah. They recognized that Allah is the creator of the heavens and the earth. وَإِنْ سَأَلْتَهُمْ, the Quran says, وَإِنْ سَأَلْتَهُمْ مَنْ خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. Allah says, if you ask the Meccans, the mushrikeen of Mecca, who created the heavens and the earth, they will surely say Allah. So why do they worship these idols? They worship these idols because they believe that God is too high, too exalted to interfere in worldly affairs. So we go to these small idols and we ask them for food, for rain. If my wife is not, can't get pregnant, I ask the idol for to make her fertile. But they recognize that Allah is the creator. So Fakhr al-Razi says that it's highly unlikely that the mushrikeen would insult God. They would curse God. So what does he say? They would respond by cursing the Prophet. And cursing the Prophet is tantamount to cursing God. You see the argument here? The mushrikeen believe in Allah. They believe that Allah is the creator. So when the Muslims curse their slander and insult their idols, they retaliate by insulting the Prophet. And insulting the Prophet is equal to insulting God. You know, there's a narration that says Ibn Abbas should be a name that's familiar to you. Ibn Abbas is the cousin of the Prophet. He's you know, I would say one of the few companions who is revered by Shias and Sunnis. Yeah, it's very rare to find a Sahabi who's loved by both Sunnis and Shias. But Ibn Abbas, you know, he's respected by both. Ibn Abbas, after the death of the Prophet, became blind. After many years after the death of the Prophet, he was blind and he was walking in the city of Medina. And as you know, brothers and sisters, one of the great tragedies of the early history of Islam is that, you know, Bani Umayyah comes to power and Muawiyah institutes the cursing of Ali ibn Abi Talib from the pulpit during Friday prayer. Imagine that. Instead of ending your sermon with Quran or with a dua, many of them would conclude their Friday sermons by raising their hands and asking the congregation to raise their hands, and they would invoke Allah's curse on Ali ibn Abi Talib. Imagine that. Ibn Abbas is walking in the streets of Medina and he hears a preacher in the mosque of the Prophet cursing Ali ibn Abi Talib. Imagine. This is the same Ibn Abbas who witnessed the great contributions of Ali ibn Abi Talib. He hears some preacher, some Umayyad preacher, cursing Ali ibn Abi Talib. So he enters the masjid and he asks, "Ayyukum sabballah?" Which one of you has slandered God? They tell him, Ibn Abbas, what are you talking about? We're Muslims. We are the ummah of La ilaha illallah. How could we slander God? He says, which one of you slandered the Prophet, Rasulullah? They say, Ibn Abbas, what's the matter with you? We're Muslims. We say La ilaha illallah and we say Muhammad Rasulullah. How could we be Muslim and slander the Prophet? He then says to them, Ayyukum sabba aliyan? Which one of you slandered Ali? They all say, oh, Ali, oh, of course. We seek nearness to Allah through our slandering of Ali. Ibn Abbas, he says, listen to me. Many of you did not meet Rasulullah. I met the Prophet. He's my cousin. I swear, لَقَدْ سَمِعْتُ حَبِيبِ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. I heard the Prophet with my own ears. Say, مَنْ سَبَّ عَلِيًّا فَقَدْ سَبَّنِي وَمَنْ سَبَّنِي فَقَدْ سَبَّ اللَّهِ. Ibn Abbas says, I heard the Prophet with my own ears say, He who slanders Ali slanders me, and he who slanders me has slandered God. Which brings me to my next point, my dear brothers and sisters. Just because you know certain things about history, just because you know certain figures in Islamic history did atrocious things, and they did, I don't think that we should be unapologetic. I don't believe that we should be apologetic. We should own our narrative as Shia Muslims. But that doesn't give you license to insult and use vulgar and inflammatory language to speak about personalities that are revered in the Sunni tradition. Because you know what will happen? When you start slandering them, they will respond by slandering Ahlul Bayt. And Allah, on the Day of Judgment, He'll hold you responsible for this. Because of your ignorance, because of your unwarranted provocation, many people began cursing Amir al-Mu'mineen. Many people started to insult Fatima al-Zahra out of ignorance, because you provoked them. You have to have wisdom, brothers and sisters. There's a hadith that says, and this is mentioned in, I believe, Nahj al-Balagha. Amir al-Mu'mineen, this is a lesson from Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib. On his way back from Siffin, some of the companions of the Imam, they were slandering and using abusive language about Muawiyah and his followers. Imagine, Muawiyah and his followers. The Imam alayhi salam says, إِنِّي أَكْرَهُ لَكُمْ أَن تَكُونُوا سَبَّابِينَ. The Imam says, I don't want you to be slanderers. Don't slander. Imagine, even Muawiyah. وَلَكِنَّكُمْ I don't permit you to slander, to just use abusive and vulgar language. I don't give you permission to slander Muawiyah and his followers. But what you should do is, وَلَكِنَّكُمْ لَوْ وَصَفْتُمْ أَعْمَالَهُمْ, describe their actions, describe their wrongdoings, shed light on their wrong actions, their deplorable behavior. وَذَكَرْتُمْ حَالَهُمْ, you can describe their low spiritual state, but you don't need to use, you don't need to mock. You don't need to slander. You don't need to use abusive language. Criticize them, but do it with dignity. Be honorable, even in the way that you speak about the enemies of God. If you do that, كان أصوب في القول, that would be a better way to speak. You know, there are some people, they just want to use inflammatory, vulgar language. The Imam says, even when you criticize, do it in a dignified way. Describe their actions. The Imam is not saying turn a blind eye to the actions of Muawiyah. I'm not saying forget about what happened to Ahlul Bayt after the death of the Prophet. You need to mention it. But do it in a way that doesn't unnecessarily provoke other people. Don't use abusive language. Mention what happened in history. But do it in a way that is respectable, that is dignified. Verse 109. وَأَقْسَمُوا بِاللَّهِ جَهْدَ أَيْمَانِهِمْ لَإِنْ جَاءَتْهُمْ آيَةٌ لَيُؤْمِنُنَّ بِهَا قُلْ إِنَّمَا الْآيَاتُ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ وَمَا يُشْعُرُكُمْ أَنَّهَا إِذَا جَاءَتْ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ. And they swear by Allah, their strongest oaths, that if a sign comes to them, they would surely believe in it. Yes? Some commentators of the Quran, they say that there were a group of mushrikeen who came to the Prophet and they say, Ya Rasulullah, you tell us about Musa. Musa had his staff that turned into a serpent. You speak to us of Isa ibn Maryam. Isa ibn Maryam revived the dead. You mention all of the miracles of past prophets. We want you to perform miracles, and we swear that if you perform miracles, they ask the Prophet to turn Mount Safa, a mountain, into gold, right? Because all they think about is money, right? turn this mountain into gold, bring the dead back to life. They were asking the Prophet, do this miracle, do that miracle. They gave him a long list of mu'jizat that they want him to do. And they said, wallahi, wallahi. Allah says, they gave their strongest oaths. You know how some people, when they really want to do qasam, they say, I swear in the name of Allah, I swear by 124,000, you know, they really exaggerate their oath. They're making a very strong oath that if you send us, if we see a mu'jiza, we will believe without a doubt. Allah tells the Prophet, tell them, قُلْ إِنَّمَا الْآيَاتُ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ. This is in Allah's hands. I am the messenger of God. I am the messenger of God, which means Allah is the speaker. Allah is in charge. Allah decides when to show miracles and when not to show miracles. It's totally His discretion. He's the all-knowing. And then Allah says, وَمَا يُشْعِرُكُمْ أَنَّهَا إِذَا جَاءَتْ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that these people, they claim and they promise and they promise that if a sign comes to them, if they see a miracle, they will believe. Allah says they're not going to believe because these people are not interested in believing. They are interested in just debating. Have you met people like that? They're not interested in arriving. They're not interested in the truth. They're not trying to find the truth. There is no quest for truth. Just debating, just arguing, just making excuses. Allah says they're making excuses. I'm not going to send down a sign whenever they ask for one. Because if they really believed, they wouldn't really need signs. They would, you know, looking in the mirror is enough of a sign. Looking up at the heavens is enough of a sign, yeah? They're not going to believe even if you fill the sky with miracles. أَنَّهَا إِذَا جَاءَتْ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ. Let me pull up verse number 110. وَنُقَلِّبُ أَفْئِدَتَهُمْ وَأَبْصَارَهُمْ كَمَا لَمْ يُؤْمِنُوا بِهِ أَوَّلَ مَرَّةٍ وَنَذَرُهُمْ فِي طُغْيَانِهِمْ يَعْمَهُونَ. And we will turn their hearts and their sights, even as they did not believe in the first time, and we will leave them in their ordinancy, blindly wandering on. Now, I just want to make one comment about this verse, because we've spoken about the stubbornness of the kuffar and the mushrikeen, and how they have almost like this intrinsic resistance to the truth. Here, you know, this verse should remind you of, you know, a dua where we say, you know, Ya Muqallib al Qulubi wal Absar. Many of you may have heard of this dua. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this verse reminds us of how much control He has over us. Now, we have free will. The verse is not negating the idea of free will. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that when I want to guide you, or when I want to lead you astray, I have control over your emotions, your heart, and your thoughts. You know, sometimes when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to guide someone, He can inspire them with a thought to go to a certain place where they will meet someone who will facilitate their guidance. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, similarly, when Allah sees that someone is stubborn, someone is rebellious, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will seal their hearts. He will seal their hearts and He will let them wander blindly, because that's the natural consequence of not being objective, of refusing to consider the possibility that this may be the truth, so I should be open-minded. So, وَنُقَلِّبُ أَفْئِدَتَهُمْ وَأَبْصَارُهُمْ is a reminder that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, yes, He controls the heavens and the earth, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala even has control over our hearts and our thoughts. So we should always implore Him for His guidance and His help, so He can turn our hearts to Him and He can inspire us with thoughts that will lead us to enjoy his proximity. Wasallallahu ala sayyidina wa nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala ahli baytihi at-tayyibin at-tahirin.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ahli Muhammad.
If we have any questions or comments, even if it's a comment, you know, inshallah, we're all in this together. And I a lot of times, you know, some of the comments really are enlightening to me, and I benefit from it.
Sheikh, we would request you to complete this ayah 110. I think you stopped at Abasaruhum.
Yeah.
Tamalam yu'minu bihi awwala marratin wa nadhruhum fi tughyanihim ya'mahun.
Yeah.
Can you please complete that for us?
So, I have a very poor translation. Does anyone have a translation that might be better?
But I have.
What's the translation that you have?
I have it in Farsi, Sheikh.
So, can someone, because I don't have a very good translation. What's the translation that you guys have for kama lam yu'minu bihi awwala marra?
So, as they believe not there at first, but we let them wander blindly on in their distraction.
Yeah. So, the verse is speaking about people who have such a strong rejection to the truth when they first encounter it. You know, there are some people, you know, it may take a few times for them to say, listen, this is not for me. But there are some, you know, individuals like, you know, Abu Sufyan, Abu Jahl, where from the moment Islam was introduced to them, they had no interest in it. They had almost an aversion to it. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we will turn their, so in this context, Allah is actually speaking about the hearts and the thoughts of the disbelievers. So Allah has turned their, He has turned their hearts. As they have rejected the first time, because they rejected so strongly the first time, you know, sometimes that seal happens a lot quicker. You know, there are some people, they're rebellious, and over time their hearts are sealed, right? For example, someone who's bedridden for months, they just lay in bed for months. They got injured and they're in bed for months. And then it takes 6 months for them to lose muscle function in their legs. It takes time, yes? And then there's someone who experiences such, you know, a serious injury. You know, in this case, I'll use the word self-inflicted injury, that immediately they lost function in their legs and it's not repairable. There are some people who are so rebellious that their rejection of truth is so intense that they essentially sealed their hearts immediately because they had such a strong opposition to the truth. So there are some people whose hearts are sealed because of gradually because of continuous, you know, rebellion and defiance. And there are people like, you know, Abu Jahl, Abu Sufyan, the seal is there from the beginning. Because again, this is a self-inflicted type of harm. And we leave them in their state of tughyan, their state of rebelliousness and transgression, wandering blindly. Meaning that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He doesn't interfere and strip them of their free will and guide them. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't end their lives, right? He lets them continue living. They just continue wandering because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He has an appointed time where He seizes the souls. He lets them wander, you know, blindly. Perhaps for them to be a lesson for others. He lets them wander in their state of, you know, spiritual blindness.
Sheikh, I have a question regarding the ayah 106. You explained how this ayah was revealed to Prophet, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi.
No.
But I see that also as maybe, you know, something that we can take directly basically as a message. And I wonder if you can comment on this.
Sure. I think it's a beautiful, you know, I think we always have to keep in mind that when we come across verses where the Prophet is being addressed, you should never think that, okay, this verse has to do with Rasulullah. I'm not the Prophet. Let's go on to the next verse. You know, yes, the Prophet is the primary addressee, but the verse is also for us. You know, so when Allah tells the Prophet, you know, follow what's revealed to you, you know, you have no God but me. I should be, you know, the object of your pursuits, and turn away from the disbelievers. I think this is a reminder that, you know, even if we live in a world where, you know, we live in a highly Islamophobic world today, but I think the message in this verse is, you know, you have to be unapologetically Muslim. You know, fulfill your responsibility towards Allah and leave it to Him. You know, yes, you know, you're going to be, you know, you're going to be abused, you're going to be discriminated against, but guess what? You know, every prophet was discriminated against. Every prophet was verbally, physically abused. You have a taklif. You need to fulfill your responsibility. Follow what has been revealed to you, right? Because you're going to be answerable to Allah on the Day of Judgment, not people. So be unapologetically Muslim, you know? Don't let anyone deter you from obeying your Lord. That's the reason why you were created, right? You were created to experience unlimited pleasure and happiness. And the only place, the only being who is unlimited is Allah. You know, as I often say to people, you know, the problem with humanity, you know, I would say the root of all human suffering stems from our relentless pursuit of infinite happiness in finite things. You're looking for unlimited pleasure in limited things, when the only unlimited being and the only infinite being is Allah. You know, so you're looking for happiness in the wrong places. You're looking for unlimited pleasure in the wrong places. So turn away from them. You know, don't let them discourage you. Don't let them deter you. You know, follow what is revealed and turn away. Turn away from them.
Sheikh, in verse 103, the translation was that vision cannot comprehend Allah. And so it's kind of interesting that it uses the word that we can't comprehend Him, or unless that's maybe a bad translation, but it seems like saying, it's interesting that it says you can't comprehend Him with vision, and not that you can't see Him. Because like you could potentially see something and not realize what you're looking at.
Okay, I see what you're saying. لا تدركه الأبصار. So what's your question exactly?
So I was wondering if you could maybe like talk about that, or just that was just something that seemed interesting to me, because
vision. I mean, la tudrikuhu, you know, means comprehend, right? Absar is the plural of basar, so the eye cannot comprehend Him, meaning it cannot grasp Him or capture Him. وَهُوَ يُدْرِكُ الْأَبْصَارِ. But He comprehends all vision. You know, anything that is seeable, anything that is seeable, anything that exists, it's within the line of His vision, you know, for lack of a better word.
Could it be like basira? Like basira, the word?
No, because the plural of basira is basa'ir. Here, absar is the plural of basar. No, you cannot say that we cannot comprehend God with our insight, because that's precisely how we witness God. When Amir al-Mu'mineen was asked, you know, have you seen your Lord? The Imam says, you know, would I ever worship a Lord that I cannot see? The Imam says, eyes do not perceive him, but the heart perceives Him. You know, God is witnessed through insight, not through eyesight.
Because the way I was kind of thinking about it was that if you say that like Allah is everywhere and everything is kind of a different manifestation of Allah, then kind of you could almost think of it as like everything that we're looking at is kind of a dimension of him, but you don't realize that, hey, this is like a dimension of Allah. You don't perceive it that way.
Yeah, I mean, everything is a manifestation of God, but, you know, there's a difference between, you know, witnessing his manifestations and witnessing his essence, right? Because Allah has, you know, he has sifat, he has attributes, and he has that, he has an essence. So Allah's essence is beyond our comprehension. You know, you can see God's signs, but you can't see God himself. So it's almost like you see the rays of the sun, but you can't see the sun itself because it will damage your eyes. I mean, that's just an example. So you might see the rays of the sun, but you cannot look at the source of those rays, right? Because, you know, you'll damage your eyes. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So it's about physical incapability of human being. This eye is about physical incapability, that you're incapable of seeing me physically or virtually.
Of human beings and all creatures. You know, there is no created being that can witness God, because to be witnessed fully with the physical eye would denote limitation. Because if your eye can capture the totality of God, that means God is limited, because you captured him with the eye, and we know that Allah is unlimited.
I have a comment on ayah number 108. I talked about, it's a comment, it's not a question. So yes, we do have the issue with our Sunni brothers or argument with them, but this speaks to the thing where people who are following certain marja are making disrespectful comment for other people. And in fact, the people who are not doing taqleed, the people who are doing taqleed are arguing that, like making fun of them, like in the issue of tatbir even. I saw people making fun of those things. And ultimately, people start abusing the marajin and those things. So I think we should apply this in all walk of our life, even within our different people in our faith even. I think so.
Absolutely. And I think if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands the believers not to use abusive language when speaking about the idols, if that's the level of akhlaq that's required in the interaction between believers and non-believers, imagine what the benchmark is for the akhlaq that's required between Muslims and between Shias themselves. So, you know, again, I really think that the biggest problem in the Muslim Ummah today is just, you know, a loss of adab. There's no adab. You know, a lot of us have lost our ability to disagree in a civilized way. And to me, if you haven't learned how to disagree in a civilized way, you've completely missed the essence of Islam. Because the Prophet says, I was sent to perfect noble character. إِنَّمَا بُعِثْتُ لِأُتَمِّمَ مَكَارِمَ الْأَخْلَاقِ. So, you know, I remind myself before I remind any of you that, you know, we always have to exhibit impeccable akhlaq, because if we're going to claim to be the followers of Ahlul Bayt, the Ahlul Bayt, they are people of impeccable akhlaq. So if you want to attach ourselves to them, we have to really focus on, you know, developing noble character.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Inshallah. So next week, same time, 7 p.m.
Inshallah.
Please keep me in your dua, and I apologize if I caused any confusion.
Thank you very much.